Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We have a somewhat of a broader session today, and I have a very distinguished panel with me to help us explore this, you know, not the standard idea of what can we do within a sector, but to look outside and see from a very broad sense what are some of the missing pieces in the group. We have Mr. Venkateswaran. He is Senior Vice President Advances from Axis Bank. Dr. Prakash Bakshi, clearly somebody that is doesn't need too much of an introduction, somebody who's led the whole effort within NABARD, outside it, to try and see what is going on in the sector. Mr. Vasudevan, one of the pioneers in the microfinance industry, somebody setting new standards, you know, of both growth as well as quality. And Mr. Srinivasan, his book is out yesterday. Again, somebody who has been a key player and continues to be post his previous role in this sector. So the panel is really quite fabulous. Unfortunately, we are missing Mr. Bajaj. He was to be here, but he has been called away by the finance minister at the last minute. So that it would be nice to get a government perspective on what he's thinking about. Well, between the four of us, five of us, we will try to do the best we can. So let me begin by setting the stage a little bit as to what is the background here, what are we trying to do, and what are some of the you know, outlines and of the debate that we will have today. We have a fair amount of time, and the request I've made to the panelists is not to make a presentation, but to really make some opening remarks and then allow room for discussion both within the panel as well as from the audience. So please do sharpen your pencils and be ready with any questions or comments that you have. So the issue in front of us, and clearly something that the Raghurajan Committee has outlined in a very sharp way, is that despite more than 50 years of independence, despite a massive movement towards nationalization, towards active support, you know, as much pressure as can be brought to bear. You look around the world, the kind of focus India has given to inclusion, there are not too many countries that have given it. If you look at the US, the CRA is really more a gesture, more something that people need to follow. There is no regulatory mandate, there are no penalties, none of that is required. Our neighbors, Pakistan and Bangladesh, they've all had interesting experiments in microfinance and inclusion. None of them have the kind of regulatory pressure that you see in India. And clearly we have sustained it from the 60s to today. There was a belief 4 or 5 years ago that maybe priority sector guidelines need to go, maybe now private sector has arrived, market-based approaches need to be taken. When Reserve Bank of India announced a new version of priority sector guidelines, they were even tighter than the previous ones that were there. Stuff that was allowed earlier was taken out because the focus clearly was that small farmers, small players need to go out there and do work. So in some ways, from the intent perspective, there is really very little, I would say, that the country has not done. Yet the results are not fabulous. You know, again, people dispute the exact numbers. And India is such a large country that 100 million here or there, you know, is almost a rounding error. Somebody will say 500 million excluded, somebody will say 600, somebody will say 400. But we have a sense, you know, as people both are responsible for institutions as well as operating on the ground, that the task ahead is far larger than the task accomplished. And no matter what people have been trying to do, there is still a very large gap that exists on the ground. Despite very large preemption, 40% of the of a bank's net time and demand deposits have to be invested in priority sector. The definitions are getting tighter and tighter every year. There is a very large cooperative banking system that you have seen. It has 100,000 points of presence on the ground, you know, using different structures. India, as you know, has 600,000 villages. If you take out the smaller ones, the mohallas, the, you know, kind of technically villages, there are about 400,000 habitations that are of a reasonable size. Against that, 100,000 branches, 100,000 points of presence is actually not inadequate. It is a pretty large number and should have been more than adequate to deliver full financial inclusion right from the get-go. For a variety of reasons, in some states it has happened, some places it has not happened. We saw a very modern innovation led by NABARD, which is the SHG bank linkage model, which took off like a rocket. If you see early pioneers, you know, people like Vijay Mahajan, you know, played a role in putting it all together, thinking through the unique self-help group kind of approach. And then from the 90s, NABARD really supported that extremely strongly. And thanks to their leadership, the program now reaches almost 4 crore individuals, has about 20,000 crores of assets outstanding. But the growth rate is flagging now. You know, what used to be 100, 150% is now at 30% per annum. And really, there is a little bit of anxiety that the volumes of money that are being given out per individual are not growing as fast. The set of services that were supposed to be offered are not as comprehensive as they should have been. There are certainly relatively new kids on the block, which is the microfinance industry, which until 2000 was struggling. 2002, 2003, you saw small players. You know, there were many of them NGOs, many of them had taken the NBFC presence, but I would say even the largest players had 40, 50,000, maybe 100,000 clients and were very pleased at that number. And clearly, most people in conversations would dismiss them as a minor sidelight. Well, fortunately for all of us, that industry has grown quite dramatically. And you see now them having crossed about 10,000 crores with a real possibility that next year they will become larger than the SHG bank linkage model in terms of total assets outstanding because the rates of growth are pretty high. But again, the challenges there are one product. Is this really what financial inclusion is all about? Very large presence in certain parts of the country. There is clearly growth happening now in other parts. Will this sustain? Some of the largest players are saying that their growth rates are starting to slow now. Of course, slow by their standards means 300% to 100%. So it's not that it's slow by any other standard. But there is some anxiety now that if indeed the very large players are stopping their, you know, process of mega growth, where are the 500 million people going to get their services from, even in this narrow sense? So these are some of the issues that I think surrounded the debate of the Raghuram Rajan Committee report. To ask the question that if indeed we want to solve these problems, you know, is there a need for a new approach? Other countries are experimenting. You know, you might have heard the whole M-Pesa example in Kenya, where a mobile phone company, I understand there is some technical detail here, but my impression is that they have been given effectively a banking license to operate with all the attendant benefits and all the attendant risks to the system of whether their branches are able to operate fully in the way that a regular bank branch might be able to do. That could be a direction in which we could go. The Universal ID Authority is now coming up. We don't quite know what does it mean for us. Is there some implication? Is there some way that will allow us to leapfrog over other efforts? But clearly there is something interesting possibly that might emerge. The business correspondent model is showing, you know, depending on who you talk to, you saw the whole morning's discussion today, you know, but clearly in terms of numbers, you're seeing some very, very large numbers, principally driven by the government payments mechanism. And the government seems deeply committed now to convert more and more of its payment mechanisms to electronic means, which means at least that leg of the business correspondent model will certainly get a lot of fillip. Now, will that ever go beyond just a payments mechanism? Will it become a full service financial services play? You know, these are all open questions here that we have. The request I have made to the panelists is to take a somewhat of a stylized view, because they are all experts in the sector. They could talk about the sector from many perspectives. But the request I've made to them is that they take one particular area of interest to them and one particular institution type. Talk a little bit about that institution. See what that institution can do, cannot do. How far has it gone? How far can it go? And what is their view of what else might be needed either to work with the same institutions, or is there a need for a completely new setup?